First of all, I hope it's okay with everybody if I speak in English. If you have, please, if you have any questions, don't hesitate to raise your hand, and I'll try to explain in French. My French is not that well, but I'll do my best. I'll try to speak slowly and loudly. So my name is Tian Mede, and I'm doing my my PhD thesis here at TFEA. I'm in my third year, and today I'm going to talk about how we can use the discrete element method in order to numerically simulate the failure that appears in snow that leads to release of a snow avalanche. So first of all, just a few words about what is the discrete element method. So it is a numerical tool to simulate the motion and the interactions of a large number of particles. So this is becoming very rapidly an important tool to solve engineering problems concerning soils, sand, clays, powders, and in our case also snow. So this is an example of a simulation that can be done with the discrete element method. It's just something that you can find on YouTube. So basically we have a number of particles, a number of spherical particles, and then we try to pull a textile, a fabric, out of this pile of particles. All of this is not an animation, this is a simulation done with the discrete element method, meaning that the positions and the interactions and the movement of all the particles are calculated with this method. So very shortly, how the method works. This is a very simplified scheme of how the method works. So we have a number of particles that move through a confined space as shown here. So we take a certain time increment, and we look at these particles, and in the first step we try to detect collisions. So we try to determine which particles are colliding between each other and which particles are moving freely through the space. Once we detect the collisions, we try to determine the contact forces between these particles. So based on the position of, let's say, two particles, such as shown here, we detect their positions, and we say, right, there is a certain interpenetration between these particles. And we set up a certain contact law, meaning that the greater the interpenetration at some point, the greater the repulsive force. This would be an example of a simple elastic contact law. Now, it might appear a bit strange to allow these particles to interpenetrate, but we have to know that these interpenetrations are very small, and we basically just use them in order to determine the magnitude of the repulsive force. We'll talk about different contact laws later, but for now, I limited myself to a simple elastic law. Once we have the contact force, we can move into the next time increment, meaning we try to determine what will happen in the next moment. So in the moment t equals t plus delta t. So we have the repulsive force acting on the two articles, and using the second Newton's law, or in French you refer to it as le principe fondamental de dynamique. We can determine the positions of the two particles in the next moment. And then this is the whole, then we just repeat this loop. Again, so we determine the new positions, we detect the collisions, determine the contact forces, go in the next time increment and do it all over again and again and again. By doing this, basically, this is the essence of the discrete element method. Okay. Let's talk about snow and how this can be used in order to simulate what happens inside the snow. So, I don't know if somebody already talked to you today about the weak layers in snow. These very thin layers of low density and cohesion. So this is the, by definition, the most fragile part of the snowpack. So basically this is what you see here. And this is a zoom into the this weak layer. And a vast majority of dry slab avalanches appear by a failure appearing in this weak snow layer. So we're very interested in how these weak layers behave from a mechanical standpoint. However, performing actual physical experiments on these weak layers is very difficult because they're very fragile. So at the moment, the most promising method of how to determine what happens inside of these weak layers mechanically is by numerical simulations, which is what we're doing here. Knowing the mechanical behavior of weak layers is obviously important if we want to understand how, where, and why release of a snow avalanche will happen. So, the way we developed our method is we take a sample of a weak layer, we put it in the X-ray tomograph. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the X-ray tomograph. Basically, this is what they use in a hospital when you break your leg. They do the X-ray tomography and they look inside your leg how your bone is broken. Basically, we can do the same thing with the snow. We take a sample of the snow, we put it in the X-ray tomograph, and we look inside the snow and we come up with this, with the internal structure of the snow. So what we see here is basically, this is what snow looks like on a micro level. It's a large number of ice particles glued together into this solid matrix. This is what we see here. So this white porous structure is basically a matrix made of ice, and in between there's many, many air pockets. When you apply load to this kind of structure, this entire structure will collapse. There will be a breakage of the matrix. These grains will separate between each other, they will move. So this structure will not remain the same. Meaning that this is extremely difficult to simulate, because most of the methods that we use to simulate how other materials deform are completely useless in a case like this, because the changes inside the structure of the material are so great that none of the other methods can be applied. However, this discrete element method seems to us as pretty much the only way how we can access the deformation of this kind of material. So, however, in order to apply the discrete element method, some hypotheses needed to have been made. For example, if we look at a point inside this structure, so all the light gray areas, this is the ice structure, the ice matrix, and everything that is black, this is air. This is basically the kind of image we get from the X-ray tomography. So the hypothesis that we made is that when you collapse this structure, when you apply load on it, and when it collapses, most of the damage will take place in the neck regions between the grains. So in these neck regions where the structure is the weakest. So basically this is how we define limits between the grains. We say, well, this is one grain, and then this is another grain, and then this is another grain, this is another grain. And we say that when we collapse the structure, it will not be the grains that break, it will be the regions between the grains, where the grains are glued together. So, based on the geometry of the structure, on the curvature of this ice matrix, we can segment the image. So we can take this original grain image and we can segment it like this. So basically meaning we identify individual grains in this matrix. Now, if we want to simulate this with the discrete element method, there's basically two more obstacles that we need to talk about. One of them is, okay, so if every grain is a particle inside the discrete element method, such as the spheres that I was showing you before, we need to make sure that these particles are actually glued together into this matrix. Okay, so if before we were talking about, here we were talking about an elastic contact law between two grains. In order to glue the grains inside the matrix, we need to introduce a cohesive contact law, meaning a contact law between two spheres that will act like glue. So, as shown here, if we try to pull two spheres apart that are connected with the cohesive law, for a certain amount of time, this will sustain a certain force, and then at some defined point, this cohesion will break. So this allows us to model this fragile behavior between the grains. So the grains will stick together, but at a certain point, this cohesion will break. So this is what we use to bind the grains together into this matrix. The second problem we needed to address was here we were talking about spherical particles, and discrete element method is very, very efficient when it comes to spherical particles. It is also possible to apply it to particles that are not spherical. However, the calculation becomes much more complicated and much more time consuming, which means that the simulation times become unreasonably long. However, we still want to mimic the shape of these grains inside the discrete element method. So what we do is we use a trick and we mimic the shape of the grains with the number of spheres. So the more spheres we use, the closer we will get to the actual shape of the grain. However, the more spheres we use, the slower the simulation. So obviously there is a trade-off, but this enables us to mimic the shape of the grains and get to have the efficiency of the discrete element method which we have with the spherical particles. So we developed a method of how to do this. I will not go into the details of how exactly we do this. Basically, we take a binary object, this could be a grain, applying some mathematical formulations on it, we can eventually mimic the shape of a grain with a number of spheres. I will leave this part out. I will just say that as I already said before, with more spheres we get to have a more accurate approximation of the grain, with less spheres a less accurate one. I suppose this is clear. So however, more spheres also meaning longer simulation times, and so there is a trade-off between the calculation time and the accuracy of the simulation. Okay, so at this point, what we did so far, we have the we measure the structure of the snow. We identified individual grains. We approximated these grains with spheres. We built a cohesion between these spheres, and now we have a model of snow based on its microstructure. And now we can actually apply simulations on it. And let's say here is an example of what we can do. This is an example of a simple compression that can be done on snow, where the red color signifies the damage taking place in the specimen. So the damage here is defined as a, for each grain has a number of cohesive bonds with the neighboring grains, and the red color signifies how many of the, of those bonds have been broken. Okay, so we can observe, in this numerical simulation, we can observe many different things. For example, here is the force displacement graph. So the blue curve is the vertical force needed to compress the specimen, whereas the yellow curve is the ratio of broken bonds, meaning how many bonds in the specimen have already been broken. So we could say that this is damage inside the specimen. So if we look at the, this is a zoom into the very beginning of the simulation. We can see that in the beginning, we apply a certain force on it. The force grows, grows, grows. Until a certain point, we start applying, a damage starts appearing inside the material. So at this point, we start breaking some bonds and the force diminishes. Then we have a large plateau when we're compressing the specimen, where the force pretty much stays on the same level, doesn't seem to rise a lot, although we're increasing damage inside the specimen. Finally, when the specimen is compressed enough, this force starts rapidly rising. This is basically due to, in this whole region, as we said before, we have a lot of empty space inside the specimen, so we can easily compress it to a certain point until we basically kill all of this empty space, and then we actually start compressing the grains, so the force rises really fast. Okay, but if we take a look at this image again, basically the loading which we are concerned about in the release of a snow avalanche is basically shear, or a combination of normal and shear. So basically, as you can imagine, these two slabs will try to slide in this manner. So it's really shearing loading that concerns us in the release of a snow avalanche. So this was an example of normal loading, but the more interesting thing is to show what happens in shear. So this is an example of what happens in shear. Let's try to go through this simulation again. Do you see that all the damage here is concentrated in this very narrow band, as opposed to the simple compression we were looking at before? Basically, we see that most of the action really happens in a very, very, very thin layer. And you will see when that this entire upper part just slides over this lower part. And then at a certain point, the whole structure just collapses. The structure is basically completely decomposed. All of the cohesion is broken, the entire matrix is broken into just individual grains.
Okay.
So again, if we can look at the same thing, we can look at what is happening with the force. So the horizontal force, this is the blue curve, the horizontal force on the needed to shear the specimen, and the yellow curve being the damage inside the specimen. Here on the left, we can again see the zoom into the initial phase of the experiment. So we see again the same thing. There is almost an elastic buildup of force. Then at some point, when damage starts appearing in the specimen, there is a failure. And then the force seems to pretty much stay constant, and then enter this very, very fluctuant phase where we get a lot of noise. And basically this is connected with a lot of damage taking place in the specimen. And if we look at the vertical and horizontal displacement, this is where the specimen collapses. So this central region here, where most of the damage takes place, and where this is basically where the structure completely collapses. And after this, not much seems to happen. This is from this point on, the damage stays constant. And also the force. So basically this last region is, this is this, right? Where not much seems to happen in the specimen anymore. It's already broken, but we still have, although there is no more cohesion, we still have some, we call it the residual force, and it's basically caused by the friction between the grains. Okay. So, in this particular experiment, in this particular simulation, we were applying a shear displacement, but we also applied some vertical force. Again, if we talk about the actual state of affairs inside the snow at the release of a snow avalanche, we have a combination of shear and normal pressure that acts on the snow. So what we want to know, what is the crucial information, is how the structure behaves in different combinations of shear force and normal force. Okay? So we can run this simulation of shearing with different values of vertical force. We can identify the failure stress. So the failure stress, we identified it here as the height of this initial peak. Okay? And so we construct something we call the failure envelope. Meaning, if we look at the vertical force and the horizontal force, what combination of vertical and horizontal force will lead to a failure inside the snow specimen? Okay, so we see at a low, if we apply a very low amount of vertical force, the material will sustain a fairly large horizontal force. However, as we increase the vertical force, the material will sustain less and less horizontal force. So this is what we would call a failure envelope. And it's if we analyze what the results we obtained here, we can see that we will have three different regimes. If we look at the first part of the failure envelope, we see the curve that I already introduced. So we get a large peak in the beginning, a lot of fluctuation connected to the collapse of the specimen, and then some residual force. The next region, this one, is particularly interesting because it seems here that again we get a certain initial peak, and then fluctuation, collapse of the specimen, and then a certain residual force. But the residual force is larger than the initial peak. What does this mean? Again, if we go back to the simulation, this means mostly what we would expect would be to material to be the strongest before it breaks. But in the regime which we looked at, the material can actually sustain more horizontal force in this phase. It actually becomes stronger when it collapses. So this is what we're looking at here. The material actually gains strength after it collapses. Here, just before I finish, I'm showing, so the failure envelope that we calculated and the residual force left, so the force that the material can sustain after it collapsed. So we can see, if we really want to talk about the strength of the material, it is the combination of these two curves that tells us how much force the material can sustain. So at low vertical force, it will be the cohesion that defines, or the initial peak that defines the strength of the material. And for larger vertical forces, it will be the residual force in a material that already collapsed, so the friction that will define how much force the material can sustain. So all of this has been done for one single specimen up until now. However, these are some preliminary results, but if we apply this to different types of microstructures of snow, we will get different results. So basically, this is one of the aims of what we're trying to do here, is produce these failure envelopes for different microstructures.